Okay, open it.
Hello, everyone. This is Poppin' Threadbare.
Look. There's no blood.
And no body.
It's another world, Booker. Another Columbia.
Something tells me one dead gunsmith ain't the only thing that's changed.
Welcome to the other side of the looking glass. Also, say hello to... I think this might be our first, rebel weapon. It's not the first we could have grabbed, but it's the first I did grab, so there's that. This is the repeater. It's a variation on the machine gun. And we'll see exactly what that means, once it comes time to actually fire it. Till then, it's awfully noisy in here. Oh, hey, he's still around. And that's still him. It's a pretty repetitive sound file.
Daisy Fitzroy. Come on, you piece of horseshit. Tell me about Daisy. Cut him loose.
What?
Garfield says cut him loose. And bring me his tools to the lockup. That'll keep him clean, I guess.
Why?
What are you, the Columbia Gazette? The chink's wife got friends in high places. Come on. We need to sell.
Interesting.
You're in a world where how Chamberlain is alive now.
Somewhere we'll find out why, I suppose.
I don't suspect you can change something like that and have everything else remain the same.
That makes a good point. There is all that cause and effect to worry about. Someone's dead. Oh well.
These men.
I killed them. They were dead.
Not in this world. Look at their noses. They're all bleeding.
Disgusting. 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 Sick. 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 Sick.
One of me.
Who do I hate? You can't tell which one. To here. Who is the eye? Which one hates which?
Jeez, way to take it hard, guys.
What's wrong with them?
They remember.
Remember what?
Being dead.
Well, I died like a dozen times. You don't see me crying. So you probably figured it out by now. But the big thing about the repeater is that it fires a lot more slowly than the machine gun. But as you can see by the barrel clip, it's got more ammunition. Well, Trooper Raven Trap.
In the other world, he was the one who was struck.
In the other world? This whole business makes my head hurt.
What, did we just kill the Finkton head of security? Also, he wasn't complaining about being dead in the other world. Well, anyway. I believe those vending machines count as already tagged, so we're just going to skip right past them. Yes, yes, very sad. But wait a second. Yep. Just had to prove it, I guess. But yes, this is new. Apparently it happened a while ago. Long enough to set one of these Nickelodeons up, I guess. that's a friend in high places. I guess to get the result we wanted, had to change a number of variables. Like the fact that A, his wife is now a white woman, and B, she happens to be the brother of Fink's head of security, who C, is not dead. Until just now. Because I killed him. Because that doesn't happen.
Open fire!
Uh-oh.
You'll be sorry.
Damn it. Running away. Cowards. Thanks for the timely notice there, Elizabeth. I guess a second's warning is better than none. Dead workers. Seems like the situation's kind of gotten worse. I got one of the heavies. It was kind of funny watching them frag themselves. Oh, there's the guy. Hey, thanks. Didn't realize you wanted a piece of this, but okay. Okay. Oh, hey.
I don't have anything.
I'm just not making the impact I was before with a hand cannon. I was figuring I could get to higher ground here, but for some reason that freight hook is not lighting up for me. Figuring maybe I just need to get to the right angle, but then again, maybe it's not that worthwhile. Alright.
Not ammo!
Aw, damn it.
Look. Looks like Fink isn't giving you the job.
Oh, okay. I imagine she wanted me to look at something in particular, but I don't know where it is, so I'm sorry, guys. I don't know what she's talking about. Except maybe that, you know, maybe in this world, Fink actually hasn't lost his mind. Realizes that, you know, trying to hire Columbia's Most Wanted is not the best idea for a security chief.
Give me a second. The broken clock tolls at midnight.
Which clock? This looks like the one.
Set it to midnight.
Hooray!
I'll be.
I came to Columbia because I believed in God and because I believed in honor. But Slade has shown me this. There is no God in shutting our brothers out from the family of man, and there is no honor in defending those who are strangers to its meaning. Perhaps in Finkton there is one more deserving of my service.
Sounds like she's gone full Vox. Unlike her, hero there. He just went insane. Was purely an alliance of convenience for him. That was definitely too high.
Catch.
Hell yeah. Okay, this is just sort of chipping away. Hoping one of these fireballs will actually hit it. Well, however I did it, I guess I managed enough damage, so all's well that ends well. You know, that's probably the same armory as before. Nothing new. But anyway, I'm gonna go see what's happened to good old Chenlin.
Do you hear anything?
Huh?
No machines. No tools.
Let's go find that gunsmith. Maybe he's upstairs now.
It's a figure of Comstock now.
Mr. Lin? Chen Lin? Excuse me, Chen Lin?
Who are you? You speak up! Speak up! Can't hear you over all these machines! Very loud!
I'm Booker DeWitt.
Stand back! These machines very dangerous. Wait downstairs with Mrs. Lin.
Daisy Fitzroy sent us. We need to talk to you about getting some weapons.
Machines very dangerous. No place for stupid people.
Want to lose pretty head?
Mr. Lin.
Downstairs!
What is wrong with him?
Remember him dead in that cell? Maybe in some way he remembers that too. How would you reconcile that?
My husband? Calm his troubled thoughts. Ease his burden. Bring Chenlin back to me.
Excuse me, ma'am. I'm looking for Mrs. Lin.
I'm Mrs. Lin?
No, I mean a little Chinese lady. She was...
Booker, this is Mrs. Lin.
They took Chen's tools. What's he got without his tools?
Well, your husband is a bit out of sorts.
If he could work again, maybe. If he could work, he'd...
Mrs. Lin, can you tell me who took your husband's tools?
Goddamn police. They took them and locked them up in the impound in Shantytown.
Would having his tools back fix his mind?
Who cares? We're not getting any guns if Chen Lin doesn't have his tools. Let's head to Shantytown.
More to the point, all of his stuff got impounded in Shantytown. And since he's a gunsmith, well...
Did you notice? Lin had a bloody nose.
Seems to be in style.
This Tara. I'm not so sure it was a good idea.
Well, too late now. Alright, any more handymen out here? Son of a bitch. Jump in on me or anything? They're just gonna scream at me from the distance. Oh, there he is. There they are. Wait a second. Son of a bitch.
Well, I can sum it up for you in one word. This, my friends, the hollow hand is the tool of the devil.
He's still looking!
Before he escapes!
What goes in its place? Whiskey! Women!
I've got ammo! Here!
One will not have that in our friendly little town. No, sir!
I guess I was just aiming low or something, because that was a lot of headshots just now. Alright, so, on to Shantytown, I guess. I think it's supposed to be Finkton, but someone decided to rename it. No one's decided to fix it since. 1500. I could buy something soon again.
If you want to ask me, ask me.
About what?
My finger.
Sorry, I didn't...
It's all right. It's as much a mystery to me as anyone else. Maybe Songbird knows, but he's not talking.
I'm sorry.
What for? I get to wear this stylish thimble to cover up my hideous deformity. I hear they're all the rage in Paris.
Oh, please. My grandfather lost one of his knuckles. It's not that big a deal. And... yeah. Let's make this a little more tricky. Or... not.
I spotted him!
Okay, there we go. I definitely want to get that RPG guy. But I appear to be hitting the railing instead. Great, and I'm hitting the thing in front of me. Okay, now I hit him.
Open it.
You bet!
Get after him!
Now let's do something a little more useful. You know what? Maybe all I need here is a better angle. Also, idiot with a club. Never ceases to amuse me. Okay, there we go. I hope he does some damage before he frags himself. You know, even if he just kills himself, that's one less RPG I have to deal with. Looks like he did some damage. Just, you know, not quite so much as I would have liked. Still, not too bad. Right, so let's just have a little quick look around here. Oh, wait, hang on. Ooh. Hidden armory machine. Nothing I want, but, you know, it's nice to know it's there. Nice to know I got a few extra bucks off of it.
Do it. Now!
On it.
So let's see here.
I'll wait down here.
Yep, that is the way to get up here where the RPG guy was. And apparently it's a good place to pick up his spare RPG. I'm not sure if you can do a melee kills only run in this game. You can get pretty far by going it like that. And yeah, that's enough of the repeater. I mean, you saw what it can do, and more importantly, what it can't do. And that back there is a new kind of vigor. But it's locked away, so we'll have to wait for our return visit to actually pick it up. Until then, it's time for another elevator ride. Alright. So, now that we've passed completely through a tear, I'd say it's a good time to visit Science Corner and try to explain exactly what's going on and how, while it may be bad storytelling, it's not necessarily bad science. Our shrinking understanding. In the beginning, there were five elements. Not four, but five. Earth, air, fire, water, and ether. In ancient Greek understanding, ether is the stuff that exists above the sky, through which the stars and planets move. The idea was that different substances contain these elements to different degrees. For instance, a tree contains earth, water, and fire. Water is associated with life, and so if you cut the tree down, killing it, the water will slowly leave. Water is also opposed to fire, and so it must all leave before you can bring the fire out with a heat source. Once both these elements are gone, all you're left with is earth, ash. These five elements are remarkably consistent throughout the ancient Western and Eastern worlds. Although China had a different set. Earth, fire, water, metal, and wood. Not sure what they thought air was. But some folks have proposed that this consistency is because the ancients were actually cataloging the fundamental states of matter. Air is gas. Water is liquid. Earth is solid. Fire is plasma. And ether is the absence of everything else. But while the Greeks proposed a few different theories on how elements and atoms worked, it took until the late medieval period and the early Renaissance for alchemists and early scientists to really prove the idea of irreducible elements. Metals were first, along with sulfur. In the 18th century, Antoine Lavoisier discovered that the reason combusted elements gain weight after combustion is because they are combining with something in the air. And he went on to identify and name both oxygen and hydrogen. He also defined the conservation of matter, which states that matter is neither created nor destroyed in chemical reactions. His theory is still mostly true, at least so long as you don't bring radiation, fission, or fusion into the mix. And even then, there's still the conservation of energy. After that, John Dalton proposed the idea of atomic weight to catalog differences between atoms of different sorts. Based on the idea that hydrogen weighs one atomic mass, carbon is 12, oxygen is 16, and so on. The idea of isotopes, where the same element can weigh different amounts, would only show up in 1913. In 1870, Dmitri Mendeleev created the periodic table of elements, a way to arrange elements based on properties which they hold in common. In so doing, he also predicted the properties of several elements which had not yet been discovered. And incidentally, he happened to arrange the elements by their electron valence bands back before anyone even knew what an electron was. We discovered electrons in the late 19th century when we created cathode ray tubes and determined that the stuff that makes them glow is electrons. At first we believed that electrons were just sort of stuck in the atoms, like blueberries on a blueberry muffin. But in the early 20th century, Ernest Rutherford discovered that each atom has a nucleus composed of protons and neutrons. And Niels Bohr proposed the idea of discrete electron orbit levels, known as valence bands. And in so doing, he explained that molecules are what happens when atoms fill these bands by either borrowing or sharing electrons from other atoms. For instance, oxygen is two electrons short of a full set, and so it can make up to two connections with other atoms. It can share electrons with two hydrogen atoms, for instance, or it can make a double bond with another oxygen atom. However, subatomic theory does not end at one level of removal. In 1911, Charles Wilson developed the cloud chamber, a special box which contains water or alcohol vapor at a very particular density. When elementary particles enter the chamber, they leave a condensed trail in their wake which is virtually unique for every particle. Armed with cloud chambers, scientists could identify the particles produced by cosmic rays, high-energy particles from space which collide with the Earth's atmosphere and produce short-lived, high-energy particles, which we wouldn't be able to create ourselves until we built particle accelerators. Cloud chambers are how we first discovered antimatter particles, like the positron, which it turns out is raining down on our heads all day, every day. And we also discovered muons, which were the first particles we ever identified which had no function in regular atoms. Muons wouldn't be alone for long, however. The number of individual particles quickly ballooned to a dozen, then two dozen, then three and four, and Pretty soon the number got so big they called it the Particle Zoo. The first few were named after letters in the Greek alphabet, but it didn't take long before they ran out. Each of these particles only lasted a fraction of a second, but since they existed at all, we had to figure out what they were. Fortunately, in the 1960s, scientists devised the quark theory, which simplified matter significantly. Nearly all of these particles, the hadrons, a definition which includes protons and neutrons, but not electrons, all of the hadrons are actually composed of three smaller particles called quarks. For instance, a proton is composed of two up quarks and a down quark, while a neutron is two downs and an up. The other flavors are strange, charm, top, and bottom. But aside from the two big guys I just mentioned, pretty much nothing that quarks create tends to last very long. Today, the number of known essential particles is a fairly manageable 18, or 31 if you account for antimatter. Six of them are quarks, and six of them are leptons. This group includes electrons, muons, taus, and three flavors of neutrino. Neutrinos are somewhat famous for being the almost massless products of radiation that can pass through anything and are almost as fast as light. The last group is bosons, which are the means by which the fundamental forces of the universe interact with mass. Photons create electromagnetic fields. W and Z bosons create the weak nuclear force, which keeps quarks together. Gluons create the strong nuclear force, which keeps protons in a nucleus. And then there's the recently proven to exist Higgs boson, which is what imparts mass to matter. The last hypothetical boson is the graviton, which would create gravity. But as always, gravity does not like working with particle physics, and we still aren't sure that a graviton even could exist. However, physicists are not yet done reducing the universe into its component parts. For instance, how is it that these essential particles can still decay into other particles? And what the hell is up with gravity at high energy states? If we want answers, we'll have to go deeper. String theory and the multiverse. String theory is only as old as the 1980s. The idea is that all matter, all energy, and all particles are composed of impossibly small strings. Strings are one-dimensional permutations of a two-dimensional plane, and they vibrate in up to 11 total dimensions in ways which allow everything that exists to exist. Every man, woman, and child, every corner of the Earth, every bit of energy we create and use, every light you see, every star in the sky, and every bit of stuff that exists between, the vacuum itself, even every universal constant from pi to Planck, all of it exists because of how the strings vibrate. Mathematically, the combined string theory, or M theory, is quite elegant and consistent. Realistically, however, there is no known way to generate enough energy to prove it, and so it remains completely theoretical. However, it does at least answer a few questions. Questions like, why does the wave function collapse? Let me explain what I mean. One of the classic physics experiments is the dual slit experiment. A cathode tube beams electrons through a pair of slits at a photosensitive plate. If electrons are particles, then they will create two bands of light on the plate, one for each slit. However, if they are waves, then they will interfere with each other and create a number of distinct bands. So at first, the experiments produced the interference pattern, which meant that despite being specific and quantifiable, individual electrons were waves and able to interfere with themselves. But then, someone set up an instrument to observe the electrons as they passed through the slits. And when that instrument was present, the electrons behaved as particles and created only two bands of light. In other words, then, the observation of the wave caused it to collapse into a particle. And there is nothing we know of outside of string theory that can explain why this happens. The way that M theory explains the waveform collapse is by saying that it doesn't. When we observe an electron and cause it to become a particle, we are not collapsing the electron. We are collapsing space-time itself so that we can only see the one version of the electron which exists in our four observable dimensions. It's like how a three-dimensional object becomes only two dimensions when projected onto a screen. A one-dimensional string in a two-dimensional field, vibrating in 11 dimensions, becomes a zeroth-dimensional particle with a one-dimensional vector when observed from a fourth-dimensional perspective. Or something like that. So, what happens to all the other possibilities while we're observing the strings? The answer is, they're still here. Every possibility exists superimposed over every other. They simply have different coordinates in these seven higher dimensions. When I was doing research, I saw at least one calculation which put the number of possible realities at 10 to the power of 500. To put that in perspective, the age of the known universe can be measured as 1.4 times 10 to the 10th power. The overall mass of the universe is somewhere between 10 to the 50th or 10 to the 60th kilograms. The number of protons in the entire universe is in the range of 10 to the 80th. And if every bit of space in the universe was occupied by a neutron, then the number of neutrons would max out at 10 to the 128th power. That means that the number of coexisting universes is around 372 orders more prevalent than the possible number of strings themselves. Even if the vast majority of them feature physical laws that don't allow for the existence of life or even of particles, the infinitesimal fractional remainder would still provide an uncountably large number of parallel realities which a person from our reality might visit without much issue beyond the energy cost that comes from crossing that kind of a barrier. This is why Elizabeth's ability to open tears is not bad science, at least not in how it interacts with M-theory. With so many possibilities, it is reasonable to assume that a few of them would resemble our own in most major capacities, but differ in the details. Details like whether a skyline or a zeppelin is present, whether a given space is occupied by a flying city in 1912 or by a Paris street in 1983, and whether a Chinese gunsmith married a Chinese woman or a white woman. You could even say that it's reasonable to encounter these minor changes more often, since they would have similar 11th dimensional coordinates. Elizabeth's most recently discovered ability has caused her to superimpose two collapsed realities on top of each other. And so the strings, which are different between realities, have temporarily reverted to waveform, which is causing the interference effect. Of course, it should resolve instantly once the particles interact with the universe again, so the game is playing pretty loose with that part of the theory. Plus, it doesn't apply to everyone equally. Personal thoughts. My favorite exploration of the parallel universe theory in fiction is The Gods Themselves, written by Isaac Asimov in 1972. That makes it older than string theory. But then the idea of coexistent realities is a fair bit older than the 80s. In The Gods Themselves, a man discovers that his supply of tungsten-186 has been replaced by plutonium-186, an isotope which is 68 neutrons short of being stable. Except that it is stable, at least at first. As time passes, the plutonium becomes increasingly radioactive, as if it is slowly growing accustomed to the laws of our universe. Eventually, scientists realize that the switch was made by inhabitants from another universe, whose strong nuclear force is stronger than it is in ours, which means that heavy elements need fewer neutrons to stay stable, and that stars need less mass to form, and thus they burn out much faster. A physicist, Peter Lamont, gets on the wrong side of the man who got famous for discovering the first batch of plutonium, and after that, he starts a personal vendetta to prove that the plutonium switching is dangerous. Sure enough, he discovers that the altered physical laws are persisting in our universe as a sort of radiation, and moreover, the radiation is affected by gravity, and so it's accumulating in our sun, which could potentially cause it to go supernova in a matter of decades. Meanwhile, Lamont's partner has been trying to communicate with the creatures in the other world, but he eventually discovers that the aliens realize this nova is going to happen, and that the ones in charge are counting on it. In part 2, we see how the aliens live. They exist as semi-permeable photosynthetic clouds with three separate genders. And there are also solid creatures who are more intelligent than the clouds and who act as their supervisors, their teachers and caretakers. It's hard to fully describe this section, especially without giving anything away. And in fact, Asimov later wrote a short story, Gold, which was essentially his attempt to explain how he'd want animators to portray this section if they ever adapted it into a movie. And how come no one's gotten on that already? We could make it today if we wanted to. Anyway, the third part returns to our reality and follows a second physicist, Dennison, as he goes to the moon to try and develop a countermeasure to the reality radiation. Essentially, he figures that humans won't want to give up something like free energy, even if it's killing them, unless they've got a decent alternative. And so, he invents a way to pull in matter from a reality with a much weaker strong force. A force so weak that all matter in the universe inhabits a single, massive star. This way it guarantees that no intelligent life will be harmed. The hydrogen reality leak thus counters the plutonium reality leak, and so the Earth is saved. At the same time, lunar separatists declare that this would be a great way to turn the moon into a free-roaming stellar body, free of the Earth's clutches. But then Dennison laughs at them, and explains just how much time and energy it would take to actually turn the moon into a starship. It's a pretty funny bit. But as for BioShock Infinite, well, I've said before that I'll be giving this game a full analysis at a later date. Suffice it to say for now that it's no the gods themselves, but I don't think it's without any merit either. Thanks for joining me again in Science Corner, and I hope I'll see you soon.